Michael Chaves is a prolific and gifted engineer, producer, and musician based in Los Angeles, California. Over the past two decades, Chaves has collaborated with the likes of Iggy Pop, Marianne Faithfull, Sarah McLachlan, John Mayer, Sia, Leanne Rimes, and Rachel Yamagata, among many others. In 2016, he became a driving force to help complete You Want It Darker, which proved to be the final album by the revered, iconic musician, songwriter, and poet, Leonard Cohen. You Want It Darker was shortlisted for the 2017 Polaris Music Prize in Canada, and so I reached out to Michael to ask him about his experiences playing on and mixing the album, what his memories and impressions of each and every song on the record were, and what it was actually like to work so closely with Leonard Cohen. Sponsored by Pizza Trocadero, The Bookshelf, Planet Bean Coffee, and Granddad's Donuts, this is Michael Chaves discussing Leonard Cohen on the 345th episode of Creative Control with your host, me, Vish Khanna. Hi, Michael. How are you?
I am great. How are you doing?
I'm very well. Where in the world are you today?
I am in Los Angeles. I just got home last night, and it's hot. I was in the pool a minute ago, but the connection was not good over there, so I'm now in my studio.
Oh, that's great. Now, I understand you went on a little bit of a moon-chasing expedition or something to do with the eclipse. Is that actually accurate?
That is accurate. When I got home from a summer tour with a lovely singer called Rachel Yamagata, I got home 3 days possibly before the eclipse, and the trip wasn't planned at all. I also got a call from another friend who had permits to hike Half Dome in Yosemite National Park in California, and those permits are hard to get, and two permits opened up. I got offered one, and I decided, and it was 2 weeks from the eclipse, so I decided I'm just going to drive into the path of the eclipse, work my way back down to Yosemite, and hike Half Dome.
Wow. That just,
yeah.
You got moon madness, basically.
Yeah. It was incredible, by the way. I don't know if you got to catch it. But
I did. I got the special glasses, and my children and I looked at it. Yeah.
It was amazing to see complete darkness. I was in the path in Idaho, a tiny little town called Weezer, Idaho.
Weezer? Like the band?
Yeah. Yeah. It's not spelled like the band, but they say it like the band.
Oh, interesting. Well, we didn't have the darkness. It was a bright, sunny day, and my kids and I were out at a playground, and then someone walking by our house just was like, "Hey, I have extra eclipse glasses. Here you go." So we just looked up, and we could just, if you looked at it, you could see the partial eclipse.
Cool.
But yeah, there was a lot of moon mania here, and I'm glad you got a taste of that.
Yeah, me too.
Well, I appreciate the time to speak with you. We are ostensibly going to be talking about You Want It Darker, a record you worked on by Leonard Cohen. But before we get into that, I'd like to know a little bit more about you. I understand you're a musician. You are in the musical realm. What is your vocational and professional and personal background, Michael?
Well, primarily, I guess you would call me a guitar player. I came on the scene playing guitar with a number of different artists, and most notably, I spent a handful of years out with John Mayer. I played on a few records in the early years, and that launched me into a world of making very cool records with your own Sarah McLachlan, for instance. I've worked with,
to be clear, you mean Canada's own. I do not own any trademark or right over Sarah McLachlan, but yes, Canada's own.
Hey, I'm practically Canadian. I mean, it's I feel like I know so many Canadian artists, but that's largely due to Leonard's son, Adam Cohen, who has been a dear friend of mine and partner in crime in terms of music since, I want to say, 1999.
Hmm. Now, would you have visited the Hillside Festival when Adam played here in Guelph?
Yes.
Oh, so you were here. You were in my town. I didn't know that.
Yes.
Wow.
I've been there before, yes.
Okay. Have you been here with anyone else?
I don't think so.
No.
I believe that was my first time was with Adam.
Right. And Adam did some workshops on top of his own set, I believe. Did you?
Yeah. We went over there. I remember.
Yeah.
I remember.
Yeah, it was only a few years ago, in the last 4 or 5 years or something like that. Yeah. Okay. So it's Adam that connected you with Leonard, obviously.
Yes. And right. Leonard has been, obviously last year we got much closer, spent a lot of time together, but I have known Leonard as long as I've known Adam, just, you know, through being my friend.
Yeah. And anyone I've talked to who has come, who came to know Leonard Cohen suggests that he had a true generosity and warmth of spirit. That was the case for you? I mean, obviously you have a working dynamic, so things can get tense, but
I don't think it ever got tense, quite honestly. The experience was just so memorably good. Everything about it was amazing.
Great. Well, like I say, this is a somewhat unusual version of this exercise I've been performing with people in terms of going through records song by song, because often I have the artist or collaborator with me to discuss things. In this case, obviously, that's not possible. So I appreciate the fact that you are willing to, because just to be clear for people who don't know, you mix the record and you perform various instruments on the record.
Yes, you could call me, in record speak, I was the cleaner.
You were the cleaner. A hugely significant role on a record, really. I mean, you're the cleaner is between the listener and the artist, basically, the step right between. Oh, and the mastering engineer and whoever else. But yes, okay, all right. All right, so this is great. I appreciate that you're willing to go through this exercise. So let's go through it song by song. And if you can, cite, you know, your memories and experiences and impressions of each song as best you can. I don't know if you want to delve into the possible intent of songs, because I think there's a real significant direct intent on much of this material. And since you've lived with it, you might have, you know, a perspective on that. But all this to say, let's begin. The first song on the record is You Want It Darker, the title track.
The dealer, I'm out of the game. If you are the healer, means I'm broken and lame. If thine is the glory, then mine must be the shame. You want it darker, we kill the flame.
A little setup on how I got involved may help the background on all of these.
Okay.
Adam, first, all of these songs were tracked with Patrick Leonard, lovely, lovely man and incredible talent, insanely talented man. And who has worked with Leonard in the past and last few records? Mm-hmm. And Patrick and Leonard tracked with a band a lot of these songs. And Leonard then asked his son, Adam, to complete the record. To pretty much produce and finish this and get it done.
I see.
And this would be December 2015. Adam gave me a call and said, hey, could you go to my old man's house tomorrow and track some vocals? He wants to punch in a couple of things, a couple of fixes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, no problem. You know, instead of sending a stranger over to the house, I went over.
This was in Montreal?
This is in Los Angeles.
Oh, in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Yeah. And so I show up at the house and, you know, I didn't bring anything. Adam said, no, you don't need a mic. You don't need a pre. Just go over there. I'm like, okay. And so I walk in. I'm like, hey, Leonard. And he's got a setup in the living room on the table. He's got a pair of monitors, laptop. What was the interface? I think it was UA's Apollo. And there's that really big blue microphone. I don't know. Blue bottle, that really bright sounding microphone, and there's two chairs, and we go. And this is when I hear the song for the first time, and I get chills because of where it was sitting. It was just it was amazing, and he just wanted to punch in and fix the refrains as he would call it. This led to much confusion too when we're Adam and I talking about choruses, and he would get confused, we'd get confused, and oh, the refrain, okay, got it.
Would the refrain in this case be Hinemi Hinemi, I'm ready my lord?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Hinemi Hinemi, I'm ready my lord.
And those are the lines that I punched in. He came and sang those lines. Those, oh, so low. Oh, my goodness. So rich sounding. Got a few takes of each of those. And we were done. I left. And I was heading out of town the following day, as I do. I travel. And he said, hey, you know, over the weekend, could you send me a rough mix of that so I can sit with him? Like, of course. So on my laptop on the road, I sent him a little mix of You Want It Darker. He loved it. And basically that this organically, it just grew. He wanted to keep fixing lines, recutting vocals. And Adam kept sending me in. And it got to the point where Leonard said, well, you know, I like your vocal sound better. Let's re-sing this song. And then there were days where Adam says, no, we need to replace that bass. And so I'd pick up a bass. Then Leonard would say, I hate those drums. So I'd go fix some drums. So that's what happened, song okay. by song. Right. We were cleaning house and making it greater.
Right. So, okay. All this to say, your fingerprints in some way, based on instructions you received from the Cohens, I mean, you're all over this record in a lot of
ways. Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes.
Okay. Now, you discuss You Want It Darker there. I don't know if you can make a general statement about your perspective on this, because I'm sure it'll song by song we'll cover this. But what is your perspective on his frame of mind making these songs, writing these songs? Because what haunts me about the record in particular is that it sounds genuinely like a fellow who knows he may be checking out and he might be
yes.
done. And that's
absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And one would think that these sessions might have been dark, you know, alluding to the title and his state of mind and the how was the feeling as we were working. And it was quite the opposite. It was not that at all. Of course, we all knew. And just a little bit of personal information from then, in about 7 months of 2016 and that month of 2015, I told you how I traveled the following day after I cut his vocal.
Yeah.
My mother was also dying, and I lost her last year.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So I spent, thank you. But I spent a better part of that year dividing my time between two 80-year-olds who were dying. And and I cannot tell you how beautiful the experience was, just to be able to have the time to be home. And when Leonard had the energy and wanted to work, I'd just fly to LA and we'd work for a week and then I'd go home. And it was quite beautiful.
Was he I've heard various reports about his physical state in the last year or two of his life, and that he'd been suffering some physical pain, I believe back pain maybe, or something like that.
Yeah, you know, his body was failing.
Yes.
It's okay. just like my mother's, both right. of their bodies were just they had enough.
Right. And
their brains were fine, but the body was failing.
The pain was overbearing. So you would work with him when he was able, essentially. Were there many sessions where it didn't happen because of his state?
And it was just basically when he was ready to work, I showed up.
Right.
That's really all I can say about that. If he was ready to go, I'd be there.
Right. So You Want It Darker, the first song, has a lovely arrangement. It's rather understated. It's rather foreboding. I mean, it suits the content of the song. Is there anything you can say about how the arrangement came to be from your perspective?
Well, it is largely in due to Adam's work on the choral arrangement,
yes.
the choir. He spent a lot of time getting that arrangement together, and he and I spent a lot of time getting the balances right. And often in my studio, we'd sit there and just get get everything sounding right. Hmm. And a beautiful arrangement that he did. And I did not go with him. He flew to Montreal to record those.
Right.
Came back with this with the choir, and that was that. It kind of dropped into place after we did the groundwork together on just the choir, and then we dropped it in. You have that. There's very little going on, you know.
Yeah, it's very sparse.
Yeah, but that was it. That filled all the space. It was plenty.
It's sparse but totally impactful, and like I say, it's among the most haunting songs I've ever heard him sing. And yeah, the arrangement has a lot to do with that. All right.
Yeah.
We're going to move on to the second song on the record, Treaty.
I've seen you change the water into wine. I've seen you change it back to water, too. I sit at your table every night. I try, but I just don't get high with you. I wish there was a treaty we could sign. I do not care who takes this bloody hill. I'm angry and I'm tired all the time. I wish there was a treaty. I wish there was a treaty between your love and mine.
This was one of my favorites because it's one of those songs that it mixes itself. It records itself. It's so beautiful. Definitely one of my favorites. And all I can really say, for most of these songs, you'll hear me say this, he changed lyrics a lot, and that's nothing new. He's, you know, what's the word on the street that he took, what, 5-7 years to write Hallelujah?
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
But yeah, down to literally the day before mastering, we're punching in because he's got a better line. And yeah, he usually has a better line. There was nothing wrong with the old one, but yeah, he's got a better one. And Treaty went through some of those changes lyrically. Musically, it was there. I don't think we touched it. You know, I did a little mix. I may have retracted some upright bass, but other than that, there was a tiny bit of arrangement and some lyric changes.
Right. And so had he recorded vocals with original lyrics that he subsequently changed, or was he just writing and changing before he laid them down?
It was literally a line, sometimes a word we would punch in.
Oh, fascinating.
So it didn't go over like through a complete overhaul. It very much is what it is, but there's maybe a line or a word or two. And they changed a few times.
But. Right. Many of the songs seem to be written to his maker. Many of them seem to be written to some mysterious muse. Do you have a sense of where or who or what or why, who or what Treaty was directed to? Because it's clearly a conversational song.
Absolutely. And, you know, my feeling, we never personally spoke about this. I never asked, like, hey, who's this about?
Yeah.
But, you know, in general, if you look at his past and his catalog, it's some muse, clearly a breathtakingly beautiful woman who has just, you know, taken over in his mind, in his heart.
Well, there are many biblical allusions to Treaty as well. I saw you change the water into wine.
I've seen
you change it back to water too. There's a miraculous aspect to this song.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And so you generally would not have in-depth conversations about his intent with a song?
No, from time to time, if there was a lyric change, maybe a little bit.
Yeah.
But you know, my job as an engineer is, you know, I'll keep my mouth shut unless I'm asked. You know?
Sure.
I mean, we had plenty of conversation, but, you know, 90% of the time we weren't talking about music. We were just talking about the news and what's going on in the world. And you know, let's order a burger, that kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, I had the great fortune of encountering Leonard once in person, and we just made very brief small talk. But for some reason, because of who he was and because of the moment, I don't know, it just always stuck with me that he seemed forthcoming as a conversationalist. Like he wanted to have a little chat, even though we were just meeting for a few moments. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. Very personal that way. Treaty is a figures heavily, or at least it has more of a weight as a piece because it recurs. We'll get to it, I suppose, later because the record closes with an instrumental version of it. So clearly it is, was that his idea or Adam's?
That was, well, it's interesting because the idea of string arrangements for a lot of these songs came up several times in conversation between Adam and Leonard. And, yeah. Me being a fan of it, I would be in the room saying, yeah, let's do it. Yeah. And I think they came up with the idea together to have this be reprised. And Leonard comes in, obviously, with the kind of spoken word at the end.
Yeah. So this has clear significance on this record. I mean, they all do, but the fact that it recurs makes me, I guess it's obvious. There's obviously they were trying to put something across about this melody and this idea of a treaty.
Oh, yeah.
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 Okay. Well, let's move on then to the next song, which is a gorgeous or musical arrangement that, again, it's infectious. It gets in my head. And my son, who's 6 years old, loves this record and this song in particular. It's called On the Level.
Let's keep it on the level. When I walked away from you, I turned my back on the devil.
My impression of On the Level, it's a rare upbeat number from our man, which was nice to hear. Just the brooding bluesy feel of it is, I think, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And on the technical side, that was the beast that I had to tame in terms of mix. It was quite a challenge, and the challenge being that some of the original vocals were tracked on different mics in different studios.
Oh, I see.
While he was punching in words or lines here and there with me, we had a microphone fail. I think the blue failed. And so I remember this morning because Adam and I went out into the back of his house to dig out his microphone. You know, we took a break. I set up his old U87. And we get back to it, and we're tracking, and he stops in the middle of tracking. You hear him say, "Hey, is that my old mic?" Yeah, that's my old microphone.
He recognized it.
Yeah, he recognized it. So just with the different mics and pre's and studios and rooms, that was challenging for me to get things to sound consistent. But I think it worked.
Well, one of the things I marvel at is the subtlety of the mix. Rather, I mean, there's a lot of layers to these songs, and even the background vocal. I believe the background vocals here were all performed by Dana Glover on this song.
Yes,
and
yes,
they've just been placed in a place where they're there, but they're kind of wispy. I enjoy it. There's a starkness to the arrangements and everything, but Leonard's voice is soaring above all of this stuff bubbling underneath.
Oh yes,
and
that's, he wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah, that was a joint discussion, I suppose, on how to mix.
Well, honestly, he has the ears of a bat because Adam would say, "Hey, kick down the vocal 1 dB," and then he'd come back in the room and say, "Hey, can you turn up the vocal 1 dB?"
That's remarkable. Very engaged in the process.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I think there's I've heard this about Bob Dylan as well. I mean, he produces all his records. Now, there's a very when you've been doing this long enough, you really know the studio. I think there's this impression that a songwriter of Leonard Cohen's stature would leave the business side of recording to the people in the room. But you're saying he was quite hands-on and quite...
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, he was generous in saying that I mixed this record. Yeah, I did a lot of groundwork and, you know, all the grunt work and EQ and this and that. But when I got to, you know, I did a lot of work in the mornings at my studio. And then when I'd go to his house, we'd make some moves together with Adam as well.
Yeah. You know? You mentioned that On the Level is an upbeat song, at least relative to the other songs on the record, and I agree with you. Do you have a sense of what he was writing about here?
I mean, other than the literal meaning of the words, keep it on the level.
I mean, I there's a lot of transitional stuff going on in this record. Transitional, I mean, in terms of life transition.
Now I'm living in this temple where they tell you what to do. I'm old and I've had to settle on a different point of view.
Yeah,
there's so much resignation there. I know we've talked about this already, but this song has this weird thing where that resignation is belied by this beautiful, you know, vibrant arrangement. It's not a it's interesting. There's a joy to it almost.
And the lines you just quoted don't sound very joyous.
No, exactly. But it's almost darkly funny when it's phrased in this song. If this same song had occurred with some of the other arrangements, it would be quite hard to take, I would think. Emotionally, I mean. Yeah. So
absolutely. Yeah. He had a way of doing that. He could sing these lyrics, and it was singing.
Yeah.
And this song, and the lyrics, it sings.
Yeah. No, it does. It's a wonderful one. Well, from there, we're going to move on to a song that I think is more in keeping with the rest of the tone in terms of musicality and in terms of the lyrics. This is Leaving the Table, which Leaving the Table really gets to me.
Yeah.
I'm leaving the table. I'm out of the game. I don't know the people in your picture frame. If I ever loved you, oh, no, no. It's a crying shame if I ever loved you. If I knew your name.
My role in this song had to do with quite a bit of editing. I know that I think Leonard wanted to give up on this one, and Adam saved this one. He really, really wanted it to work, and I'm glad that Adam pressed to have this finished because it turned out amazing.
You play bass on this one.
Adam, I did. And a lot of the instruments on this was a dear friend of Adam and myself and Leonard. So his name is Zach Ray. He's in a little band called Death Cab for Cutie.
Uh-huh, yes. I've heard of that band.
And Zach played some beautiful keyboards and some atmosphere, and it all came together, and you know, Adam somehow got it to a place where Leonard was extremely happy with it.
Do you know what Leonard's reservations were about this particular song?
I think it was mainly the vocal, because when we got, you know, the original track may not have been... This is my point of view.
Yeah,
right now.
Of course.
I believe the original music that was there probably wasn't inspiring him to just get this great vocal.
I see.
And musically, when Adam got it there, when we all got it there, and he liked it, he came in and delivered, and just it was great.
It's crushing. It's it's an incredible vocal and incredibly. Still, to me, this is a hard song to process. I mean, the mentality of someone. I this is one of the things I'm grappling with the most about this record, is just to hear someone really confront the end of life in such a bold and brave manner. I think I can't imagine being in that state. I mean, it must have been rather awe-inspiring to be around someone like this.
You said it. You said it. A bold and brave manner.
Yeah.
You just nailed it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
and on top of that, you know, the quality, it's so good. So yeah, sprinkle that on top.
Yeah. And this analogy of leaving the table, I mean, life as a table of, there's so many tables in life. And he kind of gets to all of them here. Anyway, I appreciate your insight there. We're going to move on now to the next song, If I Didn't Have Your Love. This is lyrics by Leonard Cohen, music by Patrick Leonard.
Yes.
If the sun would lose its light, and we lived an endless night, and there was nothing left that you could feel, that's how it would be. What my life would seem to me if I didn't have your love to make it real.
This one's pretty special, really special. And this came back to stripping the arrangement. And it was another one of those that there was a lot more going on. And the more we muted, the happier he got.
Yeah, Patrick plays many, what is Patrick's credits here? Drum programming, keys, bass, B3 organ, piano, and then there's another B3 organ and another electric guitar. So it is, there seems to be a lot of stuff, but it's subtle again.
Yeah, it's very subtle. And when you say there seems to be a lot of stuff, there was so much more.
Oh, so you were just muting channels, basically.
Yeah, we were muting channels. And I mean, I it's still a stark arrangement, which I really love. And that guitar tone, boy, he loved Bill Bottrell's guitar playing and the tone he got. It was just every time he heard the lick, he'd say, turn it up. Turn it up.
You know, there's various times on this record where Leonard Cohen is obviously grappling with his life, but he's also, I feel like, he's grappling with his persona as a ladies' man, as a lover, and how that desire is almost extinguished. That thing, that desire that would drive him. Do you think that's an accurate impression of where he was coming from?
Well, I feel that it's interesting. You mentioned it earlier. You touched on it earlier that these songs kind of, I don't know how he does it, man. But he could be singing about a woman, but then it flips to another higher power, maybe.
Yeah.
And so he just makes it all work, and you're just not sure.
Yeah, yeah. It's fascinating to hear him just deal with it's a total stock taking and a closing up of various human shops.
Yes.
You know, the things that drive us and maintain our desire for living. I mean, he's just shutting them all down throughout this record and acknowledging it. It's truly fascinating, as well as deeply impactful. And this song,
absolutely.
If I Didn't Have Your Love, is another example of this. And we move on again to another one, Traveling Light.
It's au revoir, my once so bright, my fallen star. I'm running late, they'll close the bar. I used to play one mean guitar. I guess I'm just somebody who has given up on the me and you. I'm not alone. I've met a few traveling light like we used to do.
Oh, definitely one of my favorites. It's hard. I haven't listened to this record in a long time, and the memories are coming back right now.
Yeah.
Wow, this one was pretty special because the arrangement, once again, Zach Ray, myself, and Adam, we worked hard on this arrangement. And when it got to a place where it was kind of groovy, and it was really grooving, I remember at one point he was ready to recut the vocal because now he was inspired. And I was just moving things around on the computer and listening. And he said, play it again. And we had it on a loop for maybe an hour. And at one point I turned around, he was up out of his chair and dancing.
He was dancing?
So that's how powerful this was to get him inspired to get that vocal.
Hmm. And I mean, the song itself is, again, another one of these ones about leaving, moving on.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, no, it's another remarkable. And you did. It says here your credit here beyond mixing is drum programming. How was that?
Yes, it was played, but I guess you could say it was programmed. I mean, it was. I played the kick drum. Oh, the ride was programmed.
Oh, I see.
Yes, that wasn't a real ride. But it was a real kick, yes.
You know, Leonard Cohen has this history of really exploring synthetic sounds. And, and I mean, he's done it throughout his discography where I think my impression is once he discovered these sounds, he was all in. And then as he moved on, he was trying to integrate his, I guess, more folk-oriented roots with these sounds. And I feel like, do you think it's fair to say this record is a nice subtle amalgamation of all of that?
Yes. And I think that's largely in part of Adam's involvement. Yeah. It was a real, real pleasure just to see these guys work together after all these years. It was amazing.
Yeah. And had Adam had much of a role in previous records by his dad?
Not hands-on.
Yeah.
They certainly had conversations about everything, about the songs, where the mix is sitting, this and that. Yeah. This is the first time it has been direct, hands-on, and Adam taking the reins and completing this record.
Yeah, I recall Leonard making a particular statement to that effect, to basically say this wouldn't have happened, this wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Adam, which seemed like a pointed way of saying, like, this, yeah, Adam had a huge role in this, yeah.
for me, it was quite entertaining to just being so close to Adam, you know, and seeing where he gets all, where he gets it all from.
Right. Right, because you know Adam more intimately than you do Leonard.
Yeah, and it was almost, I think this is why it worked together. I had the advantage because clearly so many traits at Leonard does the same thing, and I'm used to working with Adam. It's been 18 years of it, so when I got in there, it was a little similar, and Leonard, you know, I think he caught on to that. Like, I could kind of guess what Leonard was going to do next. I'm like, because that's what Adam would do.
Well, that's fascinating. That's very interesting.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, which made for a great working environment, as I said before.
Nice. Well, we have a few more left here, and we're going to move on to the next song on the record, which is relatively sparse. Again, here's another one that you played bass on. You're credited with playing the bass on it. It's called It Seemed the Better Way.
Seemed the better way when first I heard him speak. Now it's much too late to turn the other cheek. Sounded like the truth. Seemed the better way. Sounded like the truth, but it's not the truth today.
This also, the choir comes back for this one.
Yes.
And whenever the choir comes in, you can pretty much mute everything else. And it became similar to the arrangement of You Want It Darker, where let's have a lot less going on in this one.
Yeah, that impulse to do less with more. It's funny that a choir connotes less. In most circumstances, a choir would be like, that's kind of ostentatious. There's a lot going on. But yeah. To you, that's a moment of clarity or directness.
Yeah, I really love hearing the voices as the bed, quite honestly.
Yes.
It's just from traditional music as opposed to bass, drums, guitar, keys. It's nice that the bed are a bunch of voices.
Yeah.
That's how I see it. Yeah.
We were talking moments ago about how Leonard approached music and actual, you know, instrumentation. I feel like there's really no father to this style. I feel like he kind of invented this record, and like the last few records, I think, really cement him as someone who had completely his own musical sensibility. Do you think
this, I agree?
Yeah.
Specifically this song and You Want It Darker with the choir.
Yeah.
You know, I've never heard anything like that before. Whether it's folk music, pop music, it's fresh.
Did he talk much about that? Did he talk much about wanting? Were there points where he was like, "No, that sounds too much like something else"?
Well, these particular songs, I'm quoting him, where he said, "This is fresh."
Oh, really?
It was new. It was something new, and he liked it.
Okay, so he was self-aware about that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I mean, it's obviously the goal of any artist to create something idiosyncratic, but sometimes you're not even aware you're doing it. And often when you do that, it's not, you know, the reception for it can be like a confused reception. Like, I don't know what this is. Mm-hmm. He hadn't had that experience in some years. This music was embraced.
Yeah.
And I think recognized for its greatness and for its distinction from almost everything else that, you know, it's sort of familiar, but totally inventive and new. So
exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. And this one, the choir arrangement again, Adam, just knocking it out of the park.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
No, really good.
Another lovely one. So this is sort of the closer of the record in terms of, in one sense. We were referring earlier to the string reprise and treaty that we'll get to in a moment that closes the record properly. But the next and final full song, I suppose, is Steer Your Way.
Yes.
Steer your way through the pain that is far more real than you, that smashed the cosmic model, that blinded every view. And please don't make me go there, though there be a God or not. Year by year, month by month, day by day, thought by thought.
This one I think we rescued as well. There may have been a little bit of editing to get this guy together, but he finally got this great vocal after we got, this is one of those where he said, oh yeah, we need to replace that bass. So I picked up a bass, sat in the chair next to him with Adam and Leonard, and just played the bass.
Your primary instrument is guitar, but you play bass on this record. Do you often play bass?
Yes.
Okay.
I do now.
What, since this record?
No, I'm kidding. I have, well, since this record, yes, I've actually played a lot more bass gigs. I mean, I've played a bunch of instruments my whole life. If something needs to get done, I'll figure it out, that kind of thing.
It's an interesting aspect, right? When you're in that stage of production, you're a kind of a utility guy. Like, if any,
yeah.
It seems to me, as I read your credits on here in terms of instrumentation, those were likely punch-ins after the fact. Or just things that needed to be fixed?
Yeah, well, fixed or replaced. So a little bit of both.
Yeah.
I might have punched in here and there, but this song in particular, it was start to finish. That was a take.
Right.
Just played it down.
As
I believe it was the first take.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes.
So this is ostensibly, like I say, ostensibly the final dispatch from a Leonard Cohen record properly. What is your take on what this song might be about?
This song, Steer Your Way, again, he weaves in and out of, is it a girl or is it a higher power?
Yeah.
Or is it one and the same?
I think he's one of these people that revered women, seemingly anyway. I don't want to put too much, potentially give him credit maybe that he doesn't deserve, because, you know, these days everyone has an opinion about everyone and their motivations. Yeah. But my take on Leonard is that he had the sensitivity to revere women as much as he might his God.
And
he really valued women in his life. And not in a, you know, not in a lecherous man kind of way. I think he just viewed them as a higher life form. And that's my impression. I don't know if he would, anyone in his family would agree to this, but.
Well, I feel a lot of these lyrics, because of how they move in and out of that, I would tend to agree with you.
Yeah. He's framing, these are his muses, the Lord and the ladies. If I may. Okay. Well, here we are at the end. String reprise and treaty.
Particular song, as I mentioned earlier, arrangements, string arrangements of all of these was an idea. And as we completed these songs, I think he had the vision to want the treaty string reprise to be after Steer Your Way. So I know that you say technically the record is ending with Steer Your Way, but as we were making this record, he saw this.
And I appreciate your clarification there, because I'm I don't mean to dismiss this or suggest it's not worthwhile, because it does seem like there's intention, and that's what I was trying to get at earlier. But sorry, please continue.
Yeah, well, it basically he wanted to complete the record this way, and it was really beautiful. I just have this vision of his eyes closed while playing back the string arrangement over and over, just so you can listen. It's quite beautiful, quite moving.
It's rare for an artist of Leonard Cohen's caliber to leave us in peak form. I really feel like he was. I mean, was that your feeling? It seems like the experience for you was you were working with a genius, and he knew every aspect of what was going on.
Oh, yes, definitely. Yeah. If Adam and I tried to change anything while he was out of the room, he'd know.
Right.
He would know.
And do you deal, I imagine you deal with all kinds of artists. Was this unusual to have someone so immersed and engaged with the whole process?
No, I would say it's probably right down the middle. It's 50-50. Some artists, I'll just work on everything.
Yeah.
And then some artists are hands-on. They need to be there every time, and which is great. It's helpful. You know, when the artist has the vision and hears, I'm happy to be there to make it work for the artist. I won't want them to be happy.
Yeah. There is obviously externally a poetic, potentially over-romanticized aspect to the release of this record, because Leonard passed away almost as soon as prior or just after the record had come out, I believe.
I think it was just after.
Just after. But on a human level, what was that experience like for you? I mean, obviously your friend, you lost a collaborator and a colleague and a friend, and your good friend lost his father. But just experientially, I mean, the fact that the connection between his passing and this record, did you see it in some kind of, well, this is fate, or did you not even process it in such a way?
I think I believe my feeling was that he, this record quite possibly kept him alive. And when he finished, he finished.
Yeah.
That's my take on it. And it was so, I hate to just say fun, but it was really fun making this record. I think Adam and Leonard both had a good time. Adam may have been a little more stressed out from time to time, but all in all, it's the memories. Everything I take from this record is so good. It's changed me. And, you know, in addition to losing my mother last year, I have these incredible feelings. I have to share what Leonard said to me. After my mother passed, I came back, and of course, he wanted to punch in something. You know? so here we are punching in, you know, and I see him, and he knew what was going on. He knew that I was visiting and my mother in Arizona and there pretty much the whole time, unless I was coming to LA to work. And he said to me, he said, you know, you left home at 18, saw your mom on the high holidays, and these last 6, 7, 8 months, you got to know her again. I'm like, yeah. And then he says, on top of that, she got to meet the man you became. And I'm crying. I'm like, yeah. I lost it. But leave it to Leonard to point out the most obvious thing I overlooked, because clearly I spent a lot of quality time with my mom for months, and then he had to point that out. He said, you know, you're lucky. You're one of the lucky ones. It wasn't so sudden that you were there for months and months.
Well, I mean, obviously you've earned this this role, but it does seem to me that you were fortunate to get to know this man and and get to work with him. I really appreciate your insight about this record, Michael.
I wish it could be further and deeper, but quite honestly, any conversations that happened between Adam, Leonard, and myself sitting around, and Leonard's friend Bob, who was often dropped by, we would talk about so many different things, but never got into, hey, what does this mean? What does this mean?
Oh, no.
Never got there.
Yeah. Well, I imagine even if Leonard were here, he might tell me to look to the songs themselves. I mean, I will say, as a writer, he is, I think, and we all have our impressions of people's work, but I feel like the songs are direct enough that I gather some intent and
yes.
Most of the intent, but he's also a poet and enigmatic. So, what is this the material that we've heard on You Want It Darker? Is this everything you guys did, or is there anything that didn't make it?
There are a few more, and let's just say to be continued.
Okay, that's good to hear. I was curious about that too, just based on the working methods you described. I appreciate that.
Yeah,
I thank you for this. What are you up to now? What are you working on?
I am working on, I'm producing a record for a singer called Amy Vashel, and I'm trying to finish it, but I think I leave for China next week with Rachel Yamagata, but I will finish that record, and I'll finish that tour.
Okay.
And then, who knows, just, it's the life of a musician, or engineer, mixer, or producer. Just,
yeah.
If it comes, it comes.
And is there somewhere online where people can learn more about what you're up to?
Yes, I can be found on Instagram. My handle is at Don Miguel de las Chaves. And it's the same for Facebook, Don Miguel de las Chaves. It's a nickname that Adam granted me many years ago, Don Miguel.
Okay, that's a romantic, you sound like a conquistador or something. That's a romantic name.
The running joke is that I am the patron saint of tequila.
Ah, I see. I didn't realize that. Okay, so people can find, it was a mouthful. What is it again? Don?
At Don Miguel de las Chaves.
Okay, all right. We'll send people there. That sounds good. Well, Michael, thank you so much for talking with me about this record, and best of luck with everything going forward.
Oh, thank you. It's nice to finally meet you over the phone. I'm sorry it took so long.
There you go. Michael Chaves on Leonard Cohen and You Want It Darker. I found that very insightful. I'd like to take a moment. I thank Michael, obviously, for being on the show. I'd like to thank our mutual friend, Howard Billerman, for connecting me with Michael and making this happen. I've talked about this before on the show, that I'd heard stories I heard the stories from Howard. Howard had befriended and began collaborating with Leonard Cohen, and also appears with some credits on You Want It Darker. But he's been very modest about his role in all of this, but certainly played a huge role in connecting Michael and I. So again, Howard, if you're listening to this, thank you very much. And Michael, thank you once again for your thoughtfulness and for being so open to discuss this process. It sounded truly, truly magical. This is the 345th episode of Creative Control, a podcast available on iTunes, Audioboom, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, Overcast, and most other podcast platforms. If you want to learn more about the show and access episodes that you haven't been able to locate via any of those aforementioned platforms, go to vishkana.com. Learn more about me there as well. Follow the show on Twitter at @vishcreative or me at @vishkana. Like us on Facebook. Creative Control of Vishkana is a Facebook page, so like us there. And you can listen to a version of this show every Wednesday at noon Eastern Standard Time around the world at cfru.ca, or if you're in the Kitchener-Waterloo region, on the radio at 93.3 FM. Also, please visit patreon.com/creativecontrol to make a flexible monthly donation to keep the podcast going. It would be greatly appreciated, and for your efforts, I will send you, while supplies last, a t-shirt. I have 2 t-shirt designs for the show. I have some sizes left. Please let me know if you'd like one after you've pledged, and we'll work something out. I'll mail it. I'll put it in the mail is what I will do. This episode would not be possible without our sponsors, Pizza Trocadero, whom you can call for pickup or delivery at 519-829-2444, or check them out at trocaderoguelph.ca. The Bookshelf, an independently owned bookstore, bar, music venue, and movie theater located at 41 Quebec Street in Guelph. Learn more about them at bookshelf.ca. Planet Bean, freshly roasted, fair trade, certified organic coffee. More information about them, planetbeancoffee.com. And Granddad's Donuts, located at 574 James Street North in Hamilton, Ontario. Best donuts on the planet. Visit granddads.ca for information about that. Okay, if you can, subscribe to the show on all those podcast platforms. And while you're there, give us a nice rating or review, and tell your friends about the show. Download episodes, all that stuff helps, and spread the word. I'm feeling good about these in-depth album analyses, and they're going to continue for the next little bit at least, while people are willing, and I have some exciting episodes coming up, so stick around for those. I have to go now. I will talk to you soon. Goodbye for now.